actually.
Dobro večer in prav lepo pozdravljeni na večeru pripovedovanja zgodb za Grevejca. Danes je z nami prav poseben gost, Martin Vrasej. Martin prihaja iz Anglije in je pripovedovalec zgodb. Storyteller, kot rečejo v Angliji. Njegova zgodba gre tako, da se je nekje pri 23 leti po naključju spotaknil, rečemo, o pripovedovalca zgodb. On pravi, da je bila to ljubezen na prvi pogled. Ne o pripovedovalca, ne osebo, ampak v umetnost pripovedovanja. Vse od takrat pripoveduje in deli zgodbe. Moram pa najprej povedati, da je že po 9 mesecih, po tem incidentu, ko se je skoraj zaletel pripovedovalca, že pripovedoval na odru, pripovedoval svoje zgodbe in se je od takrat potoval širom Evrope, pripovedoval po šolah, po zaporih, po festivalih, po bolnišnicah, pravzaprav povsod, kjer so zgodbe lahko slišane in kot pravi Martin, za zgodbe ni meja, ker so zgodbe tiste, ki povezujejo srce. Zdaj, zadnjih 9 let je Martin svoje pripovedovanje zamenjal za skrb za ženo. Žena je pred pol leta umrla za rakom, tako da se on zdaj znova spet podaja na pot pripovedovanja z isto predanostjo, z istim entuzijazmom in z isto srčnostjo. In tisto, kar nam hoče pravzaprav sporočiti svojo umetnostno pripovedovanje, je to, da krvavo potrebujemo pravzaprav pripovedovanje. Sploh v teh časih utrujenih, ko smo en tam, mimo drugega. In mislim, da je nekaj, kar hoče tudi on sporočiti svojem pripovedovanju in to, da pravzaprav preko umetnosti pripovedovanja lahko stkemo pristne stike en z drugim. In obenem pa dodajam jaz, da s pripovedovanjem zgodb lahko spletamo pristne stike z naravnim svetom. Tudi od njega smo se utrujili. Zgodbe, ki jih pripovedujem jaz, so zgodbe iz narave, oziroma v našem društvu Terra Anima jim rečemo zgodbe poglobljene ekologije. Te so tiste, s katerimi se probamo spomniti, da ima narava srce in si probamo povedati, da je čas, da jih prisluhnemo in se povežemo spet z nami. In zato sva se danes, da se odločila z Martinom, da bo ta večer posvečen drevesom. Tihim, za naša ušesa včasih modrecem, velikim velikanom, ki čuvajo našo duhovno dediščino, velikim velikanom, ki pravzaprav nas pripenjajo na tla, da lahko potem segamo z rokami visoko in sanjamo, tistim, ki pravzaprav zelo velikrat v tej naglici vsakdanjega življenja jih ne vidimo, oziroma jih vidimo samo iz uporabniške vrednosti. Tiste globje povezave oziroma globjega razumevanja, kaj pa drevesa sploh so, pa večkrat ne vidimo. Zato je ta večer namenjen drevesom, zgodbam dreves, da jih počastimo in da mogoče najdemo pot, da se jim približamo. Z moje strani, hvala.
I have no idea what she said, but if you believe it all, I'm very happy. I want to make a little arrangement with you, please. First of all, the stories we are telling tonight are older than the mobile phones. So we want no mobile phones in the stories. Please turn them off, and let's have no little tinkling noises or other squeaks and rattles. Secondly, I am speaking English to an audience that either does not speak English very well or not at all. So if you need something translated or help, tell us. Don't sit there in silence and say, oh, what's happening? You know, do say if you don't understand anything. Good evening, you're welcome, we're just beginning, come in. Young man, do you want to sit at the front because you can see where you can see, or are you happy to? Okay. So, tonight we're telling stories about trees, aren't we?
Sure.
Trees, yes. Then, trees. Okay. Before we start talking about trees, you're all going to sing. I will sing. Will you please copy me? Okay? Off we go. Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, witchy chaya.
Hey, ay, yo.
Hey,
ay, yo.
Hey,
ay, yo.
Hey, ay, yo.
In Africa, the tortoise Trocky, who walks very slowly indeed, is known as a bit of a trickster. So the other animals don't really trust him. But one night, Trocky had a dream. He dreamt about a tree, and that tree was full of fruit. Who can tell me the name of a fruit? In English or Slovenian? If it's Slovenian, you tell me the name of a fruit. Mm-hmm. Fruit names?
You want fruit or that?
Pardon? Apple, right. Any more fruit? You must know some fruit. But pears, yes, good. More?
Strawberries.
Banana, strawberries. Everything was on the tree. I need more fruit.
Plums.
Mangoes, yes. Pineapples, grapes, plums, cherries, whatever. Yeah, grapefruit even possibly. Lemons, oranges. The tree was so full of fruit and so full of colour. When Trocky woke up, he was smiling all over his face. And he went to the animals and he said, I dreamt of a tree with all this fruit. Ha 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 ha, Trocky, there is no such tree. We will see. Trocky went to the wisest person in the forest, old Grandmother Coco. Grandmother Coco, is there such a tree? Oh yes, Trocky. How do we find it? Well, Trocky, you have to go straight down the long green path. You must not turn round, and don't forget the name of the tree, Omumba Rumbunga. I'll go, said the lion. I'm king of the animals. I should go first. Right, said Coco, Grandmother Coco. You know what to do, straight down the path. Don't turn round, and don't forget the name of the tree. And off went the lion. What a long path it is. I wonder how far I have gone. Ah! He got a thorn in his foot. Oh! What was the name of the tree? He forgot. He came back. I'll go, said the giraffe. I'm very tall. I can see a long way. Come in, come in. You're welcome. We're engaged on a search for a tree full of fruit. So, please take a seat. Make yourself comfortable.
I'll just be a while.
Okay, be a while. That's fine. And so the giraffe said, I'll go. I can see a long way. All right, said Grandmother Coco, remember, down the long green path, don't turn round, and don't forget the name of the tree, Omumba Rumbunga. And said the lion, watch out for the thorn. So off with the giraffe. Missed the thorn, that's good. I wonder how far I've gone. And put his foot in the hole, twisted his ankle. Forgot the name of the tree. So he came back. So the laughing hyena, this is too simple, I will go. Don't forget, said Grandmother Coco, straight down the long green path. Don't turn round. And don't forget the name of the tree. And watch out for the thorn, said the lion. Watch out for the hole, said the giraffe. And off he went. Oh, there's a thorn. There's the hole. What a long green path. How far have I gone? He turned round and sprosh! He was right into the mud. What was the name of the tree? He could not remember. And he came back. There is an animal in the jungle that never forgets. What's the animal? What animal never forgets? The elephant. I'll go. I never forget anything. Wonderful, said Grandmother Coco. Straight down the green path, don't look round, and don't forget the name of the tree. And off went the elephant. Mind the thorn, said the lion. Mind the hole, said the giraffe. Mind the mud, said the jackal. He passed the thorn. He passed the hole. He passed the mud. This is a lot further than I thought. I wonder, how far have I gone? The next second, he was tangled up in the trees and the creepers. He couldn't get out. What was the name of the tree? Even the elephant forgot, and he came back. But Trocky had had enough. Now I will go. Off you go, said Grandmother Coco, straight down the long green path. Don't turn round, and don't forget the name of the tree. So Trocky set off very slowly. Mind the thorn, mind the hole, mind the mud,
mind the creeper.
He went past the hole, he went past the thorn, past the hole, past the mud, past the creeper. Do you think Trocky turned round? He went on and on and on and on, and at last the path grew very wide. And in front of him was a huge green tree. And then he stared, because sitting round the tree were all the animals, and he had no idea how they got there. He looked at the animals, he looked at the tree, and then he shouted, "Amumbarumbungo!" And suddenly that tree was covered with all the fruit that you talked about that we saw in the dream. He was so happy. He smiled, he smiled, he smiled. He said, "I know what to do. Every animal take a different fruit, and when you've eaten it, plant the seeds." And that is an African story about how all the fruit trees came to be. What was the name of the tree?
Bumbarumbunga.
Anyone know the name of the tree? Oh, you can honestly come back another day.
Thank you.
Listen to her story, listen,
and she will tell.
Listen to my story,
listen, and I will tell.
Mi si faccio un delico piaciuto anche le ore. Moja zgodba je po bukvi. Najprej bom povedala nekaj o bukvi. Se mi zdi tako prav. A veste, bukov je drevo, ki zraste več kot 30 metrov visoko. Bukov je drevo, ki je v sorodu s hrastom. In že v starih poganskih izročilih so ga imenovali za kraljico gozda. In hrast je bil njen kralj. A veste, te oboke, ko jih buke otvori, te krošnje obokaste. Te krošnje so navdihovali arhitekte daleč, daleč nazaj, da so gradili katedrale. Še nekaj je, o čemer je zelo, zelo poznala. In sicer o tem, da je materinska. Da zelo bogato obrodi in da nahrani cel gost. S svojimi plodovi hrani živali, to je res. Ampak ne samo živali, včasih so iz njih izdelovali moko in tudi zelo okusno olje. Pa to še ni vse, še malo moram povedati, ker je še več, kaj je o bukvi. Bukov je poznana po tem, da je drevo skupnost. Zelo rade rastejo v tesnem objemu. In prav je dokazano, da v resnici, ko rastejo skupaj, rastejo še močnejše. Poleg tega, pa ne samo, da so drevesa skupnosti samo zato, da rastejo rade skupaj, ampak je še ena stvar, ki je zelo zanimiva in to je to, da sodelujejo, zato rečejo, da v bukovih gozdovih ni revščine. A veste zakaj? Ker bukve, ki rastejo na bolj revnih tleh, pa tiste, ko rastejo bolj na bogatih, potem s pomočjo gliv porazdelijo hranila, tako da je za vse dovolj. In zato rečejo, da v bukovih gozdovih ni revščine. Še nekaj je, kar je omenil avtor knjige Skrivno življenje dreves, ki jo verjetno vsi zelo dobro poznate, in je to, da bukve žalujejo, on jih povezuje s slonicami, ki so tudi znane potem, kako moški žalujejo za svojimi dragimi. In tudi pri bukvah je on opazil in pisal o tem, kako, kadar drevo poderajo, se one povežajo s koreninskim sistemom, se povežajo z mrtvim drevesom in mu dovajajo energijo in hranila, da bi se vrnilo nazaj k življenju. In zaradi tega velikrat opažati, kako shloda požene, no poganjek. A to še ni vse. Bukve so povezane z modrostjo. Vse veste star slovenski izraz za knjigo, kakšen? Bukva. Pol, mislim, da Švedi so tisti, ki imajo enak izraz za knjigo in za bukov. Bok, se reče. Ja? In tudi mislim, da je tako, da ta prve knjige so bile napisane oziroma natiskane na lubje bukve. Ja? Da bukov je zelo, zelo posebno drevo. Zdaj pa, meni se zdi, da vsak od vas pozna kakšno bukov, videl kakšno bukov. A bi se jaz lahko potem prosim, da za en trenutek si vsaj po svoj spomin prikliče svojo bukov. Mogoče lahko zaprete oči in se spomnite na njo. Za par trenutkov. Davnimi, davnimi časi smo povabili vse bukve, ko začnemo, ne? Pred davnimi, davnimi časi je bilo kraljestvo. Tako veliko in tako širno, si pogledal, nisi videl konca. To je bilo kraljestvo, na sredi katerega je bil pa hribček. In na sredi hribčka je bil mogočen dvorec. In v tem dvorcu sta živela mlada kraljica in mlad kralj. Sveže zaljubljena sta bila in mlada kraljica je pod svojim srcem nosila plod njune ljubezni. Zelo, zelo, zelo blizu je bil čas, ko naj bi malo detece prišlo na svet. In cel dvorec je že tako težko pričakoval ta dan. Vse je ves čas brgotalo in migetalo in šelestelo v težkem pričakovanju. Ha, in res, je prišel ta dan. Težko pričakovanje dan. Služabnice so tekali po stopnicah gor in dol, bela krilca so poplesavala, šušljalo je še bolj kot vse dneve prej. Cel dan je trajalo in vzdušje je postalo težko. Tisto začetno pričakovanje, veselo, se je začelo spreminjati v zaskrbljenost. Tudi zunaj so nebo začeli objemati temni oblaki. Nekaj je prihajalo nad grad. Tam v sobi se je kraljica borila za novo življenje in za svoje življenje. Imela je pomoč mnogih zdravilnih žensk, imela je svojega kralja ob strani. Ampak v trenutku, ko je strašen grom presekal nebo, je sobo presekal krik novega življenja. Ampak obenem eno življenje odšlo. Mladi kraljici ni uspelo. Tisto noč je umrla. In tisto noč se je rodila mala princeska. Kralj je zlomljen slonel, čepel tam v kotu. In ena izmed žensk mu je prinesla deklico v naročje. Sprejel jo je v naročje in jo pozdravil s solzami. To so bile oboje. Bile so solze sreče nad novim življenjem. In obenem solze žalosti, ker je izgubil žensko, ki jo je ljubil. Tisti črni oblaki kar nekako niso šli stran. Žalost je obstala nad gradom in mala princeska je odraščala, ampak nihče ni imel stika z njo. Zakaj bila je prestrašena? Kdorkoli se je približal, se je začela strašno tresti, stisnila se je v kot, tako da so ponavadi morali vsi zapustiti sobo in jo pustiti samo. Tako da je odraščala v svoji beli sobi, zaprtimi zavesami. Njenih mladih lic se nikoli ni dotaknila svetlobe sonca in njena ušesa nikoli niso slišala ptičjega petja. Tako je rasla, stala večja in večja in kralj vse bolj obupan. Ga obroj se postal zguban, lese so mu osivele. Ampak še en delček upanja pa je še vedno bil v njegovem srcu. In res, nekaj ga dne se je odločil. Zdaj bom pa nekaj naredil, je rekel. In je sklical vse, kar si lahko predstavljate. Čarovnice, zabavljače in še vse ostale mazače, vse, kar je bilo v deželi in vse, kar se je dalo poklicati, je povabil na svoj dvor. Po celi deželi so razobesili plakate in klicali na pomoč mladi princeski. In res, ni bilo 7 dni, so se zgrinjali na konjih in peš, tako in drugače, vsi z rešitvami in idejami, kako bodo pomagali mladi princeski. A dal od vrat ni prišel nihče. Nihče. Kralj je zaprl vrata za njimi in s tem, ko je zaprl vrata, je zaprl tudi vrata svojega srca. Obupal je, se usedel v svojo sobo in omemel. Tisti žalostni črni oblaki so še vedno bili nad gradom. Ampak smete? Pa nekje druge, ne tako daleč stran. Samo malo od gradu po potki, tam v tistem gozdu, da se ga spomnim, tistem širnem gozdu, ko je obdajal cel grad. Tam je pa pri najstarejši bukvi živel škrat. In tistega dne je bil še posebej dobre volje. In se je pritegnil, pozdravil dan in rekel, zdaj pa grem jaz na sprehod. In je šel. In ko je hodil po gozdu, in zagledal tam na enem drevesu nekaj svetlega. Spomnite, da je bil tisto obvestilo, tisti kraljevi plakat, ki je klical na pomoč. Ni bil več bel, dež ga je spral, veter ga je razpihal, črke so se malo razlile, ampak je bilo dovolj, da je pritegnilo škratovo pozornost. Šel zraven. In je prebral glavne besede. Raven dovolj, da je zastopil. Princesa potrebuje pomoč, na dvoru, dosti je bilo. Je tekel nazaj kot vetrc k svoji bukvi, zato ker škrat je dobro vedel, če kdo lahko pomaga mladi princeski, je to njegova bukov. On je imel strašno zaupanje v svojo bukov in to ne kar tako. Upravičen. Nam pride k svoji bukvi, bukov, veš kaj, princeska je, nihče ji ne more pomagati, ti lahko pomagaš. In bukov je kot vedno sprejela svojega škratka v pjem in prisala rdečico z njegovih poznamirjenih lic in rekla dobro, umeri se. In mu je povedala tako, da dobro me poskuša. Ko bo sonce začelo zahajati, in ko bo obarvalo mojo krošno bakreno, takrat mali škrat, začni nabirati listi, pa kje. čas prebija. Enega po enem. In jih pleti. Spleti v grinjalo. In potem, rekla zjutraj, ko bo sonce ušlo in ko bo moja krošnja zažarela zlato, si oprta je to ogrinjalo in ga znesi princeski. Škrat se je lotil dela. Ko je sonce začelo zahajati in je zlato obarvalo krošnjo bukve, začel delati. Čisto počasi. Enega po enega je nabiral listje in jih pletal v ogrinjalo. Bukov pa je več čas prepevala v spavanko. Tako lepo v spavanko, da si jo naše srce skoraj ne more predstavljati. Pela, pela, pela celo noč in škrat pletal, pletal, pletal celo noč. Zjutraj, sonce zažarelo, buka je bila vsa zlata, je bil mali škrat gotov. Pa si je oprto ogrinjalo in prav ponosno stopil proti grad. Ko je prišel na grad, so ga pogledali malo tako tako, kaj boš ti malček zdaj tukaj. Ampak njegova odločnost je bila tako močna, da se je stražar umaknil in bo odprl vrata. Kje je kralj, je rekel mali škrat. Jaz imam rešitev za princesko. Ali spočela so ga pogledali, ampak so ga vseeno napotili k kralju. Kralj ni imel nekaj veliko posluha, ampak odločnost malega škrata in njegova zagnanost ga je prepričala, da je rekel velja dobro. Tam pojdi po hodniku, tista zadnja vrata pa poskusi. Mislil si je, se ne bo nič, se še nikoli ni bilo. Mali škrat gre, prede do sobe in odpre vrata ravno toliko, čisto miceno, 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 da je lahko potisnil noter ogrinjalo. Film je zaprl vrata in se usedel na tla. S popolno gotovostjo, da bo vse tako, kot mora biti. In v sobi mala princeska je sedela v kotu. Najprej malo negotovo opazovala, da se to čudno reč tam na sredi sobe, ampak nekaj je bilo na tem ogrinjalu, neka posebna toplina, nekaj, kar je velo iz njega, kar ji ni dalo miru. Skozi bolj se je približevala. Tako je ima milo, da se ga dotaknila, se ni upala, ampak si ni mogla pomagati. V enem trenutku se krabila ogrinjalo, pogledala, se ogrnila. Takrat se je pozgodila čarovnija. Dekličino srce je začutilo nekaj zelo močnega. To je bila varnost, ki jo ni še čutila nikoli prej. Ker naenkrat se je počutila tako, kot da je objel svoje mame. Ker naenkrat se je počutila varno. In to je bilo tako lepo, da je začela glasno jokati. Kralj je iz svoje sobe slišal jok, je pritekel gor in je bil tako jezen na škrata, da ga je dal v trenutku zapreti v ječo. Je rekel, da si pa samo še slabše naredil ti škrat, škratovski, zaprite ga takoj. In so ga vrgli v ječo. Nič hudega. Mali škrat je imel tako močno vero, da tudi v ječi sedel popolnoma mirno in z gotovostjo, da bo vse tako, kot mora biti. Veste, solze, tam gor v tisti sobi nazaj pri princeski, niso bile solze, ki lomijo srce. To so bile solze srca, ki se zdravi. In kmalu deklica ni več jokala. Kmalu se je počutila tako dobro, da je ostala in je prvič v svojem mladem življenju odgrnila zavese. Prvič v svojem mladem življenju je odprla okno. Prvič v svojem mladem življenju je začutila dotik sonca na koži. In prvič v njenem mladem življenju so njena ušesa slišala ptiče petje. Razveselila se je. Tako vesela je bila, da je stekla ven takoj po hodniku in k očetu. Skočila mu jo naročje in oče skoraj ni mogel verjeti, kaj se zdaj dogaja. Kako je zdaj njegova hčiva v redu, pri njemu v naročju. In takoj se je pa zamislil in je rekel, joj, škrata, rešite škrata. In je rešil, kar z deklico v naročju, tekel dol v grajsko ječo in osvobodil škrata. Padel na kolena pred njim in ga prosil oproščanje. Je rekel, škrat, prosim, ti samo povej, vse, kar si želiš, vse bogatstvo, vse nagrade tega sveta so ti na voljo, samo povej, kaj hočeš. Škrat je rekel, ste kralj, mi nismo bitja materialnega sveta. Meni ni za nagrade, meni ni za denar. Mal je razmišljal, rekel, veste kaj, bi vas jaz prosil. Vse, kar pravzaprav hočem, je malo hvaležnosti za našo Bukov. Dajte se malo zavedati, da smo tam, da živimo zraven vas. Saj sploh ne veste, da smo tam. Dajte nas kdaj počastiti, pridite kdaj na obisk. Mogoče se pogovoriti z nami, veseli bomo, radi bi sodelovali z vami. To je vse, kar prosim. Aj pa še nekaj, prosim. Prosim, lepo spustite me doma, v Bukov pogrešam, je rekel. K svoji Bukvi je hotel iti. In res, seveda, kralj ga je odpravil, šprat je mahal, obenem pa že tekal nazaj k svoji Bukvi, ki ga je pričakovala s svojim velikim objemom in se veselila novic. In potem so leta še malo stekla in je že kar velika ta naša princeska, te tako kaj se gor. In nekaj dne je prišla k svojemu očetu in je rekla, oče, viš kaj, eno samo željo imam. Prišel je čas, da se grem šolat. Oče je rekel, ja, seveda, na voljo ti bojo vse najboljše šole, vse, kar si boš poželela, kar boš hotela, vsi učitelji tega sveta bodo prišli sam, seveda. No, pa ni imela tega v mislih. Rekla, viš, oče, samo eno željo imam. Rada bi se učila pri Bukvi. Rada bi se učila o modrosti drevesa, ki je pravzaprav rešilo moje življenje. Rekla, če se naučim njene modrosti, verjamem, da bom dobra kraljica. Oče, prosim, je rekla, pusti me, da se učim v gozdu. Oče je imel rad svojo deklico, ni bilo stvari, ki jih ne bi ugodil in seveda. Mala deklica se je začela učiti v gozdu. Dolge dneve je preživljala pri Bukvi, se družila s škratom, pogovarjala z drevesi, in se učila naravne modrosti. In ko je prišel njen čas, je postala kraljica. Prava kraljica. Čez vse dežele in čez vse dežele je bila poznana po svoji pravičnosti in po svoji velikodušnosti. In vladala je dolgo in srečno v sodelovanju s tistim gozdom, ki je obdajal njeno kraljestvo.
Comes from a country called Tibet. And I think historically these bowls were very holy and very secret until the Chinese invasion made the priests so poor that some of them sold bowls and they came to the West and we've discovered them. And I'm glad we did because they're very beautiful. But I like to use this bowl to make atmosphere if I'm going to tell a story that has a slightly more atmospheric content, but I have to say to you, sometimes when you hear this bowl, it wants to take you up into another place, so if you do go to the other place, please promise to come back. Fighting me. On a hill, there were three fine trees. And people said that if you dared to look on a moonlit night, you might see three green ladies dancing and singing among the trees. And the farmer whose land the trees stood on said, "Those are the spirits of the trees. They protect our land." So the tradition was handed from father to son, from father to son, from father to son, that on the evening of midsummer, the farmer would go up to the hill in the afternoon and put a bunch of primroses, do we need to translate primroses? At the root of each tree, and then come down again before it got dark, so that he wouldn't actually get involved with the spirits. And the farms were always wonderful. The farm was always wonderful. So it went on through the generations. And the farmer who was there at the time of this story had three sons. And he told them all about the tradition of the spirits of the trees and the primroses. And the oldest son, and the second son, but the third son, he listened. And when the farmer died, the oldest son took most of the farm, the second son took another large section, and they left the youngest brother a smaller section in the worst part of the land. But a strange thing happened. Over the next few years, the youngest son's farm grew and was wonderful, and everything worked. But in the other farms, nothing was working so well. And then one day, on Midsummer Eve, the oldest son saw his youngest brother going up the hill, and he shouted, "Are you still doing that primrose thing?" "Of course," he said. "The spirits need the primroses." "This is my land," he said. "I don't want you up there anymore. Tomorrow I'm going to build a new barn, and I'm going to cut one of those trees down to build the barn." And the youngest brother turned to him and said, "Remember what day tomorrow is, and leave the trees alone." So he said to his brother, middle brother, "Will you help me?" "Oh, I have to go to the market," said the middle brother, rather too quickly. The youngest brother wouldn't even answer the question. So the next day, the oldest brother went up the hill. He had all his farm workers with him. He had horses and carts, and he had a great big axe. And the youngest brother was watching from his herb garden at the bottom of the hill, and he said, "Don't touch the tree!" The oldest brother took his axe and he struck the tree, and the tree screamed. The horses ran away, the workers ran away, and he was left by himself. He said, "I will not be beaten by a tree." And he chopped and he chopped and he chopped and he chopped. And as he chopped, the wind came, and the wind went through the three trees, and the three trees complained and groaned. And finally, at the last chop, the tree twisted and fell on top of him and killed him. And later, the workers came and moved the tree and the dead man. And the second son took over his farm. So now he had... But still, his farm did not get better. And still, the youngest son's farm was going wonderfully well. And then, on Midsummer Eve, the second son saw the youngest son going up the hill. "Hey, this is my land, you keep away. I'm just doing the primroses. I'm going to build a fence round those trees so you can't possibly get to them. And I'm going to use one of the trees to do it. Don't touch the tree. Remember what day it is tomorrow." He didn't listen. He went up with the carts and the men to the second tree. And when he struck that tree, it screamed. But he thought, "I'm watching for the wind. I won't be caught like my brother was." But when the tree screamed, the workers fled, they ran away. The horses ran away. And he chopped and he chopped and he chopped. And the tree started to fall. And as it fell, a branch from the third tree swung, hit the head of the second son and killed him. They took away the tree, they took away the dead man. Now the youngest son had all the farms. He thought sometimes on a moonlit night he could see one green lady sadly dancing round the single tree. But every year he went up with his primroses. Every year he left them there, and every year his farm got better and better and better. And he looked after his family and the families of his brothers in a very generous way. And that is how it went on. Nowadays, I'm told, it's called One Tree Hill, and people say you must never ever build a fence around that farm because that tree, you must never ever build a fence around that hill because it is protected by the spirit of the tree. And there are those who say, maybe we still see them sometimes, but they're really too frightened to go up and look. So that is the story of the three spirits of One Tree Hill. Now, we've told you three stories about trees. We wanted to offer you a little challenge. Would anybody like to tell us a story that they know about a tree, a real life experience or anything? Anyone like to offer us a story about a tree? Whichever language you like.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just tell you a tiny thing. Once, when I was a child, I was in my parents' garden and I was playing with a stick. I wasn't thinking about it. And I stuck it in the ground and went in the house. And weeks probably later, I went in the garden and the stick was still there. And it was sprouting leaves. Mm. And I was totally amazed because I never thought that could happen. But that was nice. So what would you like? Another story? Okay. You sure? It's only 20 to 8, it's early. Okay. If you go to Haiti, the storyteller there will say, do you want a story? And he says it like this. He says, crick. And if you want the story, you say, crack. Crick. You want a story? Crick. That's it. So every time, if I say crick, you say, that's it. And that's how they know they want a story. It seems a long time ago that there was a man who had a daughter, and his wife died, and he married again eventually. But his new wife was not very nice to the daughter. In fact, she was horrible to the daughter. She treated her like a servant, and she was cruel to her. And then her father died, and she was left alone with her stepmother, and it was even worse. But one day, this little girl came home, and on the table were three beautiful oranges. She hadn't seen oranges for a long time. She just picked a bit of peel off them. Oh, that was delicious. Before she really thought about things, she had eaten all three oranges. And then the stepmother came in. If I find out who's eaten those oranges, somebody is going to die. And she ran. The little girl ran into the forest to her mother's grave. And there she fell on the ground and she cried and cried and cried until the ground was soaked with her tears. And finally, when she could cry no more, she stood up and out of her apron fell an orange pip into the tears. And she was amazed because it grew immediately into a little twig. So she sang to it, orange tree, grow, grow. And it grew more. Orange tree, make branches, and it made branches. Orange tree, make leaves, and it made leaves. Orange tree, make flowers, it made flowers, make fruit. And there was an orange tree with oranges on it. She picked the oranges, put them in her apron, and went back to the house. She thought she would please her stepmother with the oranges. Her stepmother ate the oranges and then said, where did you get them? I can't tell you that. You will tell me. She got her arm, she twisted the arm, and then the little girl was forced to take her into the forest, all the way to her mother's grave, and there was the orange tree. Oh, said the stepmother, And she climbed into the tree and started to eat the oranges as fast as she could. And the little girl looked and said, "Orange tree, grow." And that tree grew up, up, up into the sky. Crick!
Crick.
And the mother-in-law looked up and said, "Get me down from here! Orange tree, break." The tree shattered, and her mother-in-law fell down to her death. And the little girl went through all the wreckage of the tree searching for something, and she found an orange pip, and she planted it. And using the same song, the same system, she grew a new orange tree, full of oranges, and she filled her apron with oranges, and she went to the market and sold them. And she went to the market all the time and sold oranges, and one day I went to the market and I found her selling oranges, and she told me her story. And I said, "That's a wonderful story. May I have a free orange?" And she kicked me so hard, I flew over the sea and landed right here to tell you the story. Can I just say something about stories, or is that all right?
Yep, please
do. Okay. Sometimes when I'm telling stories, particularly in schools, somebody will say to me, "Is that story true?" And I say, "Two sisters walked through the world. One had a brightly coloured coat, a smiling face, and was welcome everywhere. The other one had a dark clothes, a serious face, and people would cross the road to avoid her." And she said to her sister, "Tell me, why do people not want to talk to me like they talk to you?" "My name is Story. Everybody welcomes me. But you are Truth. And that is very difficult for some people. Come under my cloak and we will work together. Because in every story, there is truth, isn't there?" Does anybody else want to tell us a story, true or false?
Maybe it would be easier. Mogoče pa če ima kdo kakšno vprašanje, ali za Martina, ali za mene, ali pa samo kakšno misel, ko bi jo rad podelil, ali zvečera, ali pa nasplošno v provinci, ali pa če ima kaj drugo.
What's that? Oh, has anybody got any questions they would like to ask?
Story, not questions. Story.
Story?
Yes.
You want another story?
Yeah. Crack.
Oh! All right. I warn you, I can go on all night. I have a lot of stories.
Have a lot of time.
There was a man. He was very, very, very poor. And he lived in the forest. And with him lived his wife. And she wanted a baby, but no baby ever came. And also in the house was her mother, who was blind. So the conversation in the house was pretty tedious. "I wish I could see, I wish we had a baby, I wish we had money." Every day the man would go into the forest to see what he could find for the family to eat. And he would bring back fruit, he would bring back mushrooms, or he would find small animals he'd caught. He would always find something, except this day. That day he found nothing at all. And he was beginning to think, "We're going to have to starve tonight," when a unicorn, the most sacred of animals, stepped out from the tree. But he didn't see the unicorn, he just saw meat. He picked up his bow and arrow, and the unicorn said, "Stop! Don't kill me, and I will give you a wish. One wish, one wish. And it will come true. Whatever you wish for, you will get. Think carefully, come back tomorrow, and tell me what you wish." He went home and he told his family. You're going to wish for my sight, said the mother-in-law. Of course you'll wish for my sight. No, 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 you'll wish for the baby, said his wife. I thought I should wish for money, he thought to himself. He thought all day, he thought all night. And then he went back into the forest, and there was the unicorn. Are you going to make your wish? I am. What do you wish for? I wish that my mother-in-law should see her grandchild lying in a golden cradle. You know that story. I thought you did. Yes, please.
Prosim, lepo. Prosim. A pridete gor k nama?
Torej, bilo je v davnih časih, so v tej deželi in še drugih deželah kraljevali kralji. In tej naši deželi je kraljeval kralj Matija, so mu rekli. Bil je zelo moder, pravičen kralj, ljudje so ga imeli zelo radi. Skrbel je za ljudi, se za njih zanimal, ni jih izkoriščal, ni bil krut, tako kot slišimo o mnogih kraljih, da so bili. No, ampak to so bili časi, ko so v deželo vdirali Turki, plenili po vaseh, odnašali mlade, otroke so odnašali v suženstvo, iz njih delali janičarje. Da so potem sami vdirali v deželo, da so odrasli. To so bili hudi časi. Ampak ta kralj Matija se je znal dobro upirati. Veliko bitk je dobil z njimi. Tako da so se ga po malem tudi bali. In potem so nad njega poslali enkrat res močno vojsko, ga napadli in kljub hrabremu upiranju in boju s svojimi vojaki, s svojimi vojščaki, je vendarle začel popuščati. Turki so začeli zmagovati. In kaj mu je preostalo drugega? Malo se je začel umikati s svojo vojsko, ki je bila zmeraj manjša, zmeraj večji, je padlo pod turškimi meči. Začeli so se umikati proti visoki gori v deželi, ki jo še danes poznamo pod imenom Peca. Koroške. Matijevi vojaki so dosegli pobočje Pece in uspešno prodirali proti vrhu. Turki za njimi prišli so do začetka pobočja na eno planoto, se zazrli v strmine in njihov poveljnik se je zamislil, ne, te strmine pa mi ne bomo zmogli. Ostanimo tukaj, naj se kar omakne. Ampak bomo še prišli, pa se bomo opremili tako, da bomo zmogli tudi te strmine. In tako so sklenili in potem so sklenili še nekaj, da bodo tam na tisti planoti posadili drevo. Kakšno drevo naj posadijo? Tam nekje v bližini so našli eno sadiko, se niso niti poznali, Turki niso vedeli, katero drevo je, ampak so ga izruvali majčke na drevesce. Dobro so ga skorenili led in ga presadili na sredino te planote. Tu naj zdaj raste, ko bo veliko, se bomo vrnili. In so odšli. In drevo, drevesce je raslo in je raslo in raslo. In zraslo, ja mislim, največje drevo, ki je danes v naši deželi. In ga imenujejo, kako?
Ne vem, najvišje od Mandenajevska lipa.
Najdebelejša. Najevska lipa.
Najevska lipa.
Namreč pozneje se je tam naselil kmet, ki se je imenoval Najevnik in ker je drevo raslo v tej kmetiji, je dobilo ime Najevska lipa. Kar okrog 11 metrov ima obsega. Zelo veliko drevo. In pod tistimi drevesom, nekje pod koreninami, je zakopan zaklad, ki so ga Turki tudi zakopali, ko so posadili to malo, malo lipico. In zdaj, ko je to drevo že tako veliko, največje, se pogovarja s svojimi brati in sestrami po deželi. Na Kočevskem ima kraljico roga, drevo visoko, debelo, zato ji rečejo kraljica roga. In se pogovarjata. Potem se oglasi z Germova smreka, z Pohorja. Najvišja smreka v Sloveniji. Kaj mislite, koliko je visoka?
Piše v eni knjigi.
Ja. 68 metrov. Mislite, koliko je to? To je 20-metrovna stopnica. Potem se pogovarjata obe, ali pa vsaka posebej, z Macesnom v dolini Piškice. Ta je pa pravi očak. Pravijo, da je star 1000 let. In potem pogovor seže tja na Solčavsko, k Solčavski Tisi, ki je tudi zelo stara dama. 700 let pravijo, da je stara. In tako ta pogovor teče med temi izjemnimi, starimi in visokimi drevesi, ampak mi ga ne razumemo dobro. Če dobro poslušamo, pa če smo na kresno noč, ki imamo srečo, da imamo praprotno seme v žepu, potem pa lahko kaj slišimo in razumemo, ampak to srečo ima malo kdo.
In ne smeš vedeti, da ga imaš.
Še to me zapravijo, ja, jaz sem slišal, da tudi lahko veš, no, mogoče imate vi prav, ne. Vsekakor se kdaj pogovarjajo tudi o tem zakladu tam pri Najevski lipi. In vsa ta drevesa so si enotna v tem, da pravijo med sabo, da naj to nikar ne izve turško veleposlaništvo v Sloveniji.
I love it when the audience doesn't listen too quietly, but they join in as well. That's always good. Do you have a story for us?
Maybe. Kjero hočete? Ali od treh bratov oziroma treh sinov pa od smrek? Ali od fanta, ki je šel pa kupo cegeljc?
Od smrek.
Od smrek?
Od smrek.
A po Gorenjske zastopte? Je bil en kmet. Je mu kmetijo, lepe njive, travanke, ampak najbolj del tiste nogave kmetije so bile pa gmajne. Mejhne uravnic, pa ga v breh, pa še viš gor. Je tako, kakor je v štoricah, je mu tudi tri sinove, morajo biti trje. Pa mehno v letah je že bil. Je bil približno take vse, kaj jaz teh že imam. In je premašaljval, je bil moder mož, je premašaljval kmetija mora jati naprej, kjer mu ob zapustil. Taprv mu ponovat pravijo, taprv in taprv, nema vse paše, ta druh ne grejo po svet. Ta druh je ponovat zmer mu faulast, pa mu on kak grata, ne. Ali pa tamalmo. Tamal se tpa smil, pa tudi mar bi dobro bo, da bi tamal kaj dobil. Ampak je prespal to svojo tuhtarijo, pa je rekel, ja najbolj, da ima v testa naredemo, to pa nič iz Pogorenjsk, bohet, kako se je Pogorenjsk rekla. Skušna mora biti. In najbolj cajt za skušnje v nedelah popolne, kak kmetje nadevajo. Takrat je cajt. Pride na dela, nedeljsko popovne, fletna, pojužna, reče, Fotor, ta naj starmo. Hravamo v pogledat po nivah, pa ga ogmajno, kako kaj rase, pa ko. Fant se meh na mulu, pa se pa mislijo, če fotor reče, pa pejmo. Pa grasta čez nive, gledata, kako všenica rase, gor čez travenke, pa gor v gmajno go. Kako je bo prijazna, senca, dišav je, brovnice, mahovje, smreke, ja, prav prijazna hoja. Ko pa prideta v vrh, tam je ena ravninca mehna, pa prav oče, ja no, pa bo do sedva. Sedeta, pa sta van cajt kar tih, okoli sebe gledata. Fant je mislil, ja pa, pa bo kar tih. Po, pa fotr, oče, možakar, pogleda ga v tiste vsoke smreke, pa prav. Če bo tola vse toje, koga pa ti naredil? Fant pogleda v tiste smreke, vsoke, debele, pa prav. Če bo pa tola vse moje, vse posekam, predam, veliko denarja zaslužim, pa dobro živim, pa moje, da kar da smrt. Oče nič rekel, je rekel, no, pa pejva čez en cajt. V kvantska do, dam, je vse v redu, kako bo čez teden, pa v kakšen devov, ki ima kakšen kot za bit, in je teden tekel, kukor ima na kmetah za tečet. Spet nadela, zdaj, kjer ni mame, jaz domnivam, da je mama kakšna južno skuhava, pa kakšno tako reč, ampak križnik, ki je tole štorico zapisal, on kjer nič ne umeni. To sam jaz mislim. Jaz so mogla, a ne? No, po južno, pa reče ta druhmo, ta sredenmo. Hrava mal čez njive pogledat. Ta je bil kaj za to, ta je bil tak hajtežen. Pa pejva. Pa jo je hitro navezal, pa niti nimo cajt gledat, pok je po nivah, nehaj kar vlekva naprej, da je ata skor teko za nemo. Pa ga v breh, tam je pa mejhna sapaha dejala, tam je pa pol mejhna bolj počas stopil. Pa tudi, ko v gmajno prideš, si sploh ne moreš laufat, če so ravnica, če so breh, to te kar nekaj potegne, da mu bolj počas stopiš, da mejhne okoli sebe gledaš, da mejhne gledaš, da mu vtičke pošušaš, da se kakšna rečka je poduha, in res, grasta gor, pa fant je mislil, ja, koga? Pa va kar da vrha go. Misliš pa čist da vrha go, da vrh se je rekve v hradiš. Meh na niži dosta sedva. Je mislil, a obrovnice naberava, pa mendejane se je nadela popolne. Ne, sta sedeva, pa prav. Koga pa ti naredil, fotor, a ne? Ka pa bi ti naredil, če bo tola vse toje? Je ko iz neha zletel, nič ni duhtov. O, jaz pa tola vse posekal, pa bi lekve hiše naredil, take, ki jih imajo v mestah, na več štukov. Pa bi se dobro imel. Eno bajto, pa še ta drugo, pa ta treto, krmal sem pa kaj hodil. Eno levško, drugo pa je bil. Tata je bil kar tih, kar mehno tvaj pogledal, pa sta jo spet nazaj na vazava. Dej nam neč par podvava, kako je bo ta drug teden, kako kar ta prejša, del je bil. Dej pa nadela, pa nadelska južna, ja ne vem, aj bo kaj hoveje župe, a jo ni bo. Havsenikov mislim, da niso pošušali. Ampak popolne, cajt, da se gre pogledat po nivah, po maj, je pa Tamalmo rekel. Pejt, hrva, je rekel Tamal. A ta pa pejva. Pa sta fletno vkrpšva, pa sta malo po nivah pogledova, kako kaj rase, pa sta ho po travenkah gledova, pa je tam malo še tam pri kraj imel porajco, da mende še en rehrat tam rase, pa ne vem, vse tako rči videl, pa je rekel, a ta lej, pa poglej, pa sta vse sorte pogledova, pa fletne počas ho v hrib. Mejhne sem, pa mejhne ke, pa še mejhne ke, pa posod je bo kaj zavideti. Dišal je, tičko so pel, ta bolj dolo za dnam na vrvo, je bo pa tih, kot tih, ki je včasih smarekal v manj, ko hodeš, pa ko skor samega sebe slišiš, ko sam smareke stojejo, ki je čist drhač, kakirkoli drhot, in sta posedva tam na rob, moja stara mama brekva na rov, pa sta tam ancaj cedeva, pa sta pa kar tih, čistih sta bila, pa pravata, ti, če bo tola, to je vse, koga pa ti naredil? Fant prav počas reče, jata, če bo tola vse moje, koga bi naredil? Nič, lejk so lepe smareke, pust objah, naj rasajo še naprej. Kjermo, jata, kmetijo pustu.
Tretmo.
Res je. Tretmo jo je zapisal, pa dobrega ju ženo. Pa so vse, tis rod, pa še nasleden, pa še en poj. Srečna, pa zadovoljna živel.
Zdaj pa skoraj začela, da moramo iti domov. Jaz imam še eno idejo, ampak ne vem, to pa ne bom sama počela. Malo se mi je zazdel, da bi bilo zelo lepo, če bi mi skupaj zapeli eno pesem, predem bi se poslovili. Pa se mi je zdela lipa lepa. Pa lipo znamo pa po mojem, da skoraj vsi zapeli, ne? Če jo skupaj zapojemo, pa noben mu ne bo naroden. A lahko? Da se povežemo vsi skupaj, pa z drevesi, pa da zaključimo ta večer.
You're going to sing a song? Slovenian folk song.
How lovely!
Yes.
I'm looking forward to that.
Ne, pa tle dole tudi jaz prišel. No, pa mi bo pomagaj, da mi pomagaj začetko.
Viš, jaz ne pojem prav dobro.
Se, jaz tudi ne, se za to. Pa kar kakšen ga bo še pravi, ne veš, potem.
Marička, kjer ga?
Kaj pa čva?
Ne vem. Kjer kaj poje?
Peva, kaj le peva, ne?
Peva.
Ste z nami, boste peli, a ne?
Lipa zelenila je tam z lišičem gaju. Cvetje me posipala, jaz sem raju. Veje raste zavala, knjigu je visoko, meni pa je do srca, sigala globoko. Meni pa je do srca, sigala globoko. Ptičice je viljena, sinčico obavila, kadar ležal sem pod njo, me je ogradila. Zdaj pa že je ribica, skoraj omenila, cvetje lišče zlomljeno, zima je vzela. Cvetje lišče zlomljeno, zima je vzela.
Spavaj,
spavaj, ljubica,
vešče,
spala, nova luna zelena, novi cvet pognala, zopet bodo ptičice, ptičice vesele. Zmena prepila je pesmi
Hvala lepa vsem, ki ste prišli. Hvala, da ste skupaj so ustvarjali ta večer. Hvala.
Pa še kdaj ne.
Še kdaj.
Well then, you'll have to sing some more. Ready? Hey, witchy-chaya.
Hey, witchy-chaya.
Hey, ay-yo.
Hey, ay-yo.
Hey, witchy-chaya.
Hey, witchy-chaya.
Hey, ay-yo.
Hey, ay-yo.
We've had some stories.
We've had some stories.
Time to go.
Time to go.
We've had some stories.
We've had some stories.
Cheerio.
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 Thank you very much. You've been a lovely, lovely audience. Thank you. Bravo. We've got a club story thing here. You can make evenings with these people. Marvelous. Fabulous. Very good. I like to say to people, the stories you hear are gifts from us to you, but they stay alive if you tell them. So, if you heard a story in English, translate it into Slovenian and tell it to somebody else because it keeps it alive. Thank you.